partial operations of the MRT-7 expected to begin by the last quarter of 2025. The Transportation Department says the North Avenue Station up to the Quirino Station of MRT-7 will be up and running by the said period next year. On the other hand, the San Jose Station in Bulacan could be operational by 2027 at the earliest. The MRT-7 is a 22-kilometer rail service that consists of 14 stations with a capacity of carrying up to 300,000 passengers daily. Once fully operational, it will reduce travel time from Quezon City to San Jose del Monte in Bulacan to 35 minutes. The Guadalupe Bridge in Mandaluyong set to undergo retrofitting starting October or November of next year. The Metro Manila Development Authority says it will be temporarily closed, but not completely, to the public during the rehabilitation period. Now, only two of the bridge's five lanes will be closed. The MMDA also assures the riding public partial closure will not happen until the construction of temporary alternative bridges for both southbound and northbound traffic is finished. The construction of these temporary bridges will begin January of next year. The MMDA is already preparing a traffic management plan for both the construction of the temporary bridges and the actual retrofitting of the Guadalupe Bridge, which is expected to take 17 months. The Philippine Central Bank terminates its contract with Alcar, the supplier of the national ID. Finance Chief Ralph Recto says the decision was due to the supplier's supposed failure to deliver any or all of the goods specified in the contract. The Banco Central says the contract is the subject of a pending arbitration between the two parties and is therefore prohibiting disclosing matters related to the proceedings. The Philippine Statistics Authority, meanwhile, advises the public that aside from the physical ID, the national ID can be acquired in digital formats. The central bank is responsible for printing the national ID, with a PSA taking charge of gathering the data that goes into those cards. More than 51 million Phil IDs have been printed and distributed as of the end of May. Meanwhile, 87.6 million citizens have registered for the national ID, with an eventual target of 100% registration. The Committee on Basic Education and Culture at the Lower House adopts a resolution urging the Department of Education to suspend the regular academic program for 8 to 12 weeks. This to allow the agency to implement an effective learning recovery program. Committee Chairman Roman Romulo says the program will focus on teaching math and reading subjects to students from Mondays to Fridays. He urges the DepEd to decide on the specific policies of the program.
So gusto natin, hinto muna tayo, 8 to 12 weeks, yung pinaka-basic competencies, reading comprehension, grade level appropriate, at math, grade level appropriate, doon tayo para makita natin talaga yung kung nasa nakatayo yung bawat estudyante. Ibig sabihin ba, after the 8 weeks, lahat sila back to regular programming? Katulad na rin yung hindi po. Ang mangyayari, after the 8 weeks, may assessment test ulit. Yung kinakailangan na tuloy-tuloy, sabi ng DepEd, payag sila itutuloy-tuloy nila yung intervention programs, meaning sa reading comprehension at sa mathematics.
Frederick Go, the Philippines' economic czar, pushing for a VAT refund for travelers in a bid to boost tourism in the country. Jackie Pascual tells us more.
Go! Philippine economic czar Frederick Go wants value-added tax or VAT refund for tourists to attract more foreign visitors and make the country a shopping destination. At the National Retail Conference and Expo in Pasay, Secretary Go also called for expansion of the electronic visa or e-visa system.
In Asia, has VAT refund for tourists? We don't. So if we indeed want to become a shopping capital of Asia or of the world, we need to have those two as basic. These are very basic, very fundamental to becoming a shopping capital.
When asked if the country can afford to refund tourists, he said the policy would attract even more visitors, which will add more revenues for government. He added 90% of expenses of tourists go to hotels, transport, and food, all of which are not covered by the refund, and the tax stays with government.
We hardly have any global shoppers here. So you're computing 12% on a very, 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 very low base. If you increase the volume, you won't lose taxes. In fact, you'll collect more taxes.
The Philippine Retailers Association agrees with the proposal, saying this can make the country a shopping hub, benefiting not just the retail sector, but the overall economy.
Tourists whose intention or main consideration is shopping shy away from the Philippines. They go to Thailand, they go to Singapore, they go to Hong Kong, where they can do shopping.
It was just in Singapore. It was so convenient. I hope the Philippines would follow the same. No, it was very convenient for any tourist, you know, and I'm sure it will entice the tourists to shop more in the Philippines.
Retailers at the conference, meanwhile, remain optimistic of the growth of the sector with or without foreign tourists, saying domestic consumption is still strong, especially as the holiday season approaches.
Gift giving is always one of the key segments, so a lot of the retailers will always try to find ways to how to make their products a primary gift that is worth giving.
Retailers are now hoping for the economy to continue to improve and inflation to ease further to improve Filipino household spending. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The private sector is urged to boost climate resilience efforts as extreme weather events are expected to be more frequent and more severe. Lady Vicencio with this report.
Extreme rainfall events like monsoon rains in July that brought heavy flooding in Metro Manila could be more frequent, according to disaster scientist Professor Mahar Lagmay. In a forum organized by the Yuchenko Group of Companies, Lagmay stressed that extreme weather events pose a threat to communities and businesses if their potential impacts are not mitigated.
The hazard is the rains that are heavy and torrential, translating into big floods that affect communities. We had a sample, which is the Carina event, the Habagat 2024, from 10,000, I think just for one city, during Undoy, it was 10,000 rescue calls. For Carina, it became 85,000 calls for rescue. So our problem is getting worse, and such events like the one that happened on July 24, 2024 has become more frequent. It's a one every 100 year rain return event, and the last time that we had one was another like that was Ondoy and maybe Ulysses.
Lagmay says the private sector has a crucial role to play in building resilience against climate change. To reduce the impacts of climate change, local government units and businesses are being encouraged to use probability risk assessment. He adds less than 5% of LGUs use this tool, despite being part of the Philippine Development Plan since 2019. This approach allows decision makers to consider future climate scenarios to avoid maladaptation.
If so, we will underestimate the scenario.
Cater for climate change, sustainability, and disaster preparedness in their curriculum.
We have embedded the courses that actually ensures that students will get this learn this concept of sustainability.
Lagmay also points out the private sector can drive significant change by investing in sustainable finance to promote environmental sustainability, such as allocating resources to projects with green building designs and climate-resilient infrastructure. For businesses, such investments will not only protect assets, but also ensure the continuity of operations during and after disasters. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
Now, before we get those inflation numbers, well, prices at the pumps headed higher again following the big-time oil price rollback we had this week. Estimates from the Energy Department show a liter of gasoline will go up by as much as 45 centavos per liter next week, while the price of kerosene will increase by up to 55 centavos. As for diesel, it may either see no adjustment or see a 20 centavo per liter rise. Now, the Energy Department cites geopolitical tensions in the oil-rich Middle East, changes in Libya's production, and the looming U.S. rate cut for the uptick.